So it's my pleasure and honor. Good evening, my professors and colleagues. And this meeting, it is very focused meeting because I'm going to discuss only one point, 2D or not 2D, what the situation of vitamin D in treating COVID-19, either for prevention or treatment. I'm going to discuss it under these points, starting with the introduction, then vitamin D and the respiratory infections in general. What are the proposed mechanisms of vitamin D against COVID-19 and infections? Vitamin D and antiviral drugs, its relationship to other antiviral drugs and COVID. And the lastly, final statements. To start with, as Professor Magdi Sharqawi mentioned in the beginning, am I going to recommend nutrient support? This is the situation in COVID. In COVID, this is the environment of COVID: inflammation, oxidative stress, platelet activation, endothelial dysfunction, altered coagulation. Everything is disturbed in COVID. What is the rationale? If this is the vitamin E, vitamin C, carotenoids, minerals, polyphenols, all these nutrients can help by reducing inflammation and oxidative stress. This is why the media is very busy to support the patient or not. And I think from the nutrients principles, if there is any deficiency, I think it is wise to be corrected. And this is the rationale and the mechanisms behind the effects of vitamin E, vitamin C, through inhibition of inflammatory cascade, polyphenols, inhibition of platelet aggregation and prothrombotic activity in COVID, and others. If I'm going to the vitamin D, which is our focus today, vitamin D is proposed to stimulate the macrophage production of catalysidine, which is antimicrobial, regulation of nuclear factor kappa beta activity, levels of interleukin 6, interleukin 1b, TNF alpha, and the production of GM, CSF, interleukin 4, interleukin 5, VCAM, ICAM, E-selectin. So it is in inflammatory environment. Daily or weekly doses of vitamin D showed protective effect against acute respiratory infections. Where the story started since 3 years by this systematic review and meta-analysis, including participant data. So more than 10,000 participants from 25 randomized controlled trial. These meta-analysis showed an overall protective effect of vitamin D supplementation against acute respiratory infection in general. A number need to treat is 33, and it is good number for the efficacy of vitamin D support. And the benefit was greater in those receiving daily dose or weekly vitamin D without additional boluses. So if we give small dose on a chronic basis, it is better than to give boluses. And I'm going to explain this later in this presentation. Number need to treat is 20, it is even more valuable. And the protective effects against acute respiratory infections in this group were strongest in those with profound vitamin D deficiency at baseline. So if we have evidence of vitamin D deficiency and the number need to treat is 4, this means it is very beneficial. So this is in general before the era of COVID-19. And these findings support the introduction of public health measures such as food fortification to improve vitamin D status, particularly in settings where profound vitamin D deficiency is common and which is expected in the era of COVID with social distancing and bed bound. By the way, if we want vitamin D to be active from the skin, we should be exposed to sun with naked upper and lower limbs for a sufficient period of time. And be aware, because using windows windows is a big barrier for the beneficial effect of sun. This is why we are expecting vitamin D deficiency even in sunny countries. To increase the debate, this is the data from UK Biobank, including more than 300,000 UK Biobank participants. Of them, 449 had confirmed COVID-19 infections. Univariate analysis showed that the hypovitaminosis D, especially if vitamin D is less than 25 nanomole per liter, is associated with increased odds ratio of COVID-19 infection. However, multivariate analysis showed no significant difference between, and the vitamin D deficiency is not independent factor for COVID-19, especially if it is analyzed and adjusted to the other characteristic like obesity, black color, etc. So UK Biobank, including a large number of cohort, it is at the end of the day, it is a negative correlation between vitamin D concentration and COVID infection. However, this is a very nice commentary showing that adjustment in analysis, because univariate in Biobank was significant, correlating the hypovitaminosis D to COVID-19, and the adjustment is very complex. So this is why we should take every data by cautious. Another data from University of Chicago, this is a retrospective cohort study, observational study. Patients tested for COVID-19 from March to April, vitamin D deficiency was defined by the most recent 25 hydroxyvitamin D less than 20 nanogram per ml, or active vitamin D less than 18 picogram per milliliter within 1 year before COVID-19 testing. Among 4,000 patients tested for COVID, almost 500 had a vitamin D level in the year before testing for COVID. What is the relationship of COVID with vitamin D? As you see here, the lower the level of vitamin D, if it is less than 20, the percentage of COVID is 20%. And if it's above 40, it is reduced to 12%. So it seems that there is a relationship between vitamin D level and the incidence of COVID. And they showed if we take from 4,000 to 5,000 international units of vitamin D, native vitamin D, this means to be divided by 100, so 40 to 50 microgram of native vitamin D daily may be a reasonable approach facing this dilemma. Another study showing that it is not only the incidence of COVID-19, so this is the incidence of COVID-19 per million population, the lower the level of vitamin D, the higher the percentage of infection with COVID-19, and moreover, increased mortality as well. So lower vitamin D level is associated with increased incidence of COVID and increased mortality. Another interesting data came from this article. It correlated COVID-19 and the latitude. So it is data from 88 countries were included in this study. And the main points, there is a significant correlation that was found between latitude and COVID-19 fatalities. Countries closer to the equator have lower COVID-19 fatality rates than those that are further from the equator. Ultraviolet radiation from sunlight increases with proximity to equator. Insufficient sunlight, if we are far from the equator, explain this correlation. And the reported vitamin D deficiency in COVID-19 fatalities may be related to lack of sun exposure when we are far from the equator. Can we test for calcium as a biomarker instead of vitamin D as a sample tool, because serum calcium is available everywhere? This study showed three levels of serum calcium, So less than 2 millimole per liter, and between 2 to 2.2 millimole per liter, and above 2.2 millimole per liter. 2 millimole per liter means of 8 milligram per deciliter. So we multiply by 4 to change from millimole to milligram per deciliter. So this, if there is hypocalcemia, if it is less than 2 millimole per liter, this means less than 8 milligram per deciliter. This is the relationship. There is increased risk, as you see here, 23% risk of death in comparison to 0% in other groups of calcium. So hypocalcemia that may reflect imbalance of vitamin D is associated with mortality and a lot of comorbidities. And I think serum calcium is an easy way. What are the mechanisms of vitamin D, mechanism of action in COVID-19? And this is a proposed mechanism of beneficial effects of vitamin D. If we take vitamin D and the RAS system, if we look here, this is the classic RAS that all of us know. We have angiotensinogen that is transferred by renin to angiotensin 1, and by angiotensin converting enzyme 1 is transferred to 2. Angiotensin 2 is, when it is highly elevated, is bad because it's associated with increased inflammation, fibrosis, and apoptosis. We have angiotensin converting enzyme isotype 2, AC2, which is beneficial. It changes, converts angiotensin 2 into 1 to 7 with the consequences of protective pathway, reduction of inflammation, reduction of fibrosis and apoptosis. The problem is in COVID-19, COVID-19 inhibits angiotensin 2, type 2. This means inhibits the protective pathway and is associated with increased angiotensin 2 and inflammation. Vitamin D is very fantastic because it inhibits renin, inhibit angiotensin converting enzyme, so it reduces angiotensin 1 and angiotensin 2, bad factors, and it stimulates AC2, so it stimulates the protective pathway. So vitamin D reacts on the RAS pathway like ACE inhibitors. And this is in a very simple way. Vitamin D reduces ACE with subsequent reduction of angiotensin 2, increases AC2 with increasing the protective effect of AC2 that is reduced by COVID-19, and inhibits renin. So by this way, vitamin D behaves as anti-RAS. Another signals of activity of vitamin D, it plays with immunity. So it increases T regulatory cell. T regulatory cell is the principal defense against uncontrolled inflammation. We have two types of T cells, T helper cell and T regulatory cells. T regulatory cell is a subtype of T helper cell that reduces the magnitude of inflammation. And it is increased by vitamin D. So vitamin D reduces inflammation through amelioration of immunity. Again, if we stimulate vitamin D receptor either by vitamin D or active vitamin D, we can expect all these beneficial effects, starting from reduction of all these cytokines, improving neutrophil activity, and here as well, improvement of epithelial repair and integrity of pulmonary epithelial barrier, and the reduction of coagulation and thrombosis. All pathways are targets of COVID-19. Again, the RAS system is ameliorated with beneficial effects of the lung, as I mentioned in the previous slides. In pediatric population, if we look at the left side, vitamin D reduces autoimmunity, reduces adipose tissue inflammation, lung fibrosis, aromatase activity, and estradiol, with subsequent reduction of cytokine storm. So it is very beneficial in pediatric age. And this is the molecular mechanism of immune system component effects of vitamin D supplementation on T cell, reduces TH1, TH17, which are inflammatory, increasing TH2, which is anti-inflammatory, and it affects B cell, plasma cell, neutrophil, infected cells, and increase antimicrobial peptides like human cathelicidin peptide, which is increased by vitamin D. On the respiratory system, reduce inflammation and reducing interleukin 6, so it reduces the COVID, the disease. It is not only COVID, but also it's beneficial for all autoimmune diseases in pediatric population. It reduces type 1 diabetes, multiple sclerosis, rheumatoid arthritis, SLE, Crohn's, and other autoimmune diseases, and improve lung as well, reducing pulmonary fibrosis. So it seems that vitamin D is beneficial for health. For adults, this is the situation. If we are in a vitamin D-related state, glutathione is increased by active vitamin D. So vitamin D increases glutathione, that is the counterpart of reactive oxygen species. And if you look here carefully, these triangles are anti-inflammatory cytokines. So if there is repletion of vitamin D, everything is fine and inflammation is controlled. Suppose that we are in a state of vitamin D deficiency, what happened? Glutathione is depleted with subsequent increased, all these red stars are the pro-inflammatory cytokines and anti-inflammatory cytokines are reduced. So cytokine increased and cytokine storm with subsequent derangement of all body systems, lung, epithelium, cardio, and vascular system, leading to the problems. There are a lot of myth with vitamin D because still we are lacking randomized controlled study. So I agree with this commentary that it is all observational studies are enlightening us and raising questions rather than putting an answer. Another point in vitamin D is interactions with antiviral drugs. Remdesivir was stated by randomized controlled studies that may be beneficial for treating COVID-19. Maybe the evidence is still not so strong, but it is very potential drug. And there is a synergistic effect between vitamin D and remdesivir. So vitamin D potentiates the action of remdesivir and also reduces inflammation. What about tocilizumab? Tocilizumab, it is humanized monoclonal antibody against interleukin 6 receptor. This is a large study. This is a retrospective cohort study that is it is very recent published and showing that this is the number of patients treated with the standard of care. And these are the number of patients treated with intravenous infusion of tocilizumab. And if it is not available in intravenous form, and sub-Q form is present, so we have sub-Q and intravenous tocilizumab treated. Tocilizumab was given either intravenous at 8 milligram per kg body weight up to 800 milligram in two infusions, 12 hours apart, or if the intravenous form is not available, it is given subcutaneous 162 milligram administered in two simultaneous doses, one in each thigh, in a total dose, 324 milligram in total. So this is atezolizumab, a retrospective cohort study showing that atezolizumab, if you look at just look at death rate in atezolizumab, either sub-Q or intravenous, it is around 7%, overall 7%, in comparison here, 20% in standard care. With the conclusion of this study, atezolizumab in this large cohort of patients, if it is administered intravenous or sub-Q, might be capable of reducing the risk of invasive mechanical ventilation or death in patients with severe COVID-19 pneumonias. Why am I speaking on tocilizumab in vitamin D presentation? Because I like this letter to the editor. Vitamin D behaves like tocilizumab. It inhibits interleukin 6, so this may be a cheaper and simple alternative to tocilizumab if it is proven in clinical trial. This is why I am a little bit convinced, and I think the discussion will be hot in this point by this pragmatic protocol by evaluating the patients, by applying these questions when the patient is admitted to the hospital. His body mass index is low. Did the patient lose weight in the past 3 months? Did the patient reduce food intake or expected to reduce it in the next few days? If the answer of any of these questions is yes, the patient needs nutritional support. This is needless to say, to combat infection, nutrition is important in general. And this is the way of this protocol is giving whey protein, 20 gram per day. This is like milk preferably during meals. Daily allowance of multivitamins and vitamin D, either 50,000 unit if vitamin D is less than 20, or 25,000 unit if it is between 20 to 30. And then to assist the patient, if there is derangement, here the expert in nutritional support may be requested. So I think it is a general treatment. Final statements of vitamin D. This is from the Medscape, NICE, a National Institute for Health and Care Excellence, on June 29, so 3 days ago. They reviewed all observational studies and they reached that there is no evidence to support vitamin D for COVID-19. But my point is, vitamin D intake, which is recommended per day for the adult, the average is 408 international units per day to be taken from the sun or from the diet. If we are staying at home and we are away from the sun, so how to take this allowance? And I think increasing the intake to 1,000 unit to 4,000 unit, 25 to 100 microgram per day from native vitamin D, I think it is needed, badly needed in these situations, even if there is no sufficient evidence. And I think supporting the nutrients with zinc, vitamin D, and ascorbic acid in the era of malnutrition and staying home, I think it is needed if there is no evidence. The clear answer will be after the results of all these clinical trials. This is a sample of clinical trials are ongoing to testing vitamin D, either to reduce COVID-19, or this is one of the axes. Does vitamin D protect against COVID-19? Does it protect against severity? Is there any preference to give vitamin D in small or boluses? All these are questions under ongoing trials, and we are waiting the interventional studies. Until this time, I think it's better to give the patient the sufficient nutrients as supportive of care and staying home and exposed to sun. And by the way, to be protective, the upper limb and lower limb should be naked for a sufficient period of time. And by this way, I finish my presentation just announcing tomorrow 4 p.m. we are waiting the second session of Professor Hisham Said about the convection, the second principle of hemodialysis. I'm going to stop here, and I'd like to hear from you and from your discussions and your comments. Dr. Mu'tasim, you can help us in just unmuting Dr. Saeed Khamis. Start with Dr. Saeed because he raised his hand. Dr. Saeed. Dr. Saeed.
Yes, sir.
Yes, please. Dr. Saeed. Yeah. Thank you for attendance. What's your comment?
Thank you, Professor Hussein. Regarding the, it was an elegant lecture, actually.
It is a very short, yes.
Yeah, but it is a point, it is.
Yes.
One comment, as you know, this inflammatory status of this COVID-19 and so plus avoid the sun exposure to the patient due to hospital admission and so on. And as you know, that the half-life of this active vitamin D, it is 15 hours only, I mean the active form. So is inflammation and this condition, I mean, the acute illness itself can lead to acute deficiency of vitamin D. That's number one. Number two, regarding the calcium, as you said, calcium, maybe it will be deceiving sometimes, because if the patient is prolonged bedridden and he will develop hypercalcemia due to he is on ventilator and stay for 1, 2, 3 weeks, and we should closely check the calcium and not to be deceived by the level of calcium, because it can be lead to hypercalcemia and you are over enthusiastic to supplement vitamin D and so on. So we should be cautious. That is my question. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Professor Saeed, for your very relevant 2 points. Regarding the second point, yes, we should take the patient as a whole and not only serum calcium, because this is the dilemma, and the patient may be immobilized, may be hypercalcemic, but if in general population you find hypocalcemia, this may be a clue for hypovitaminosis D. Regarding the state of acute inflammation, does it reduce vitamin D? I think the vitamin D, because of lack of the sun exposure and the lack of the nutrients in the diet, this is one pathway. And the second pathway, it is not only simple like this, because vitamin D binding protein is a key player in the scenario of inflammation. So it is very complicated pathway. I'd like to hear from Professor Magdi, because as you know, he is interested in vitamin D. And then Dr. Magdi can help us in this point, if you have points to add.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Hussein, Dr. Saeed, for a very interesting issue. Vitamin D, calcium, metabolism, infection, and COVID-19. I think what Dr. Hussein covered is there is a relation between hypovitaminosis D or low level of vitamin D and infection. COVID or other than COVID, we know that it's occurring with TB.
HIV and others.
And HIV and other viruses. And all patients with deficient vitamin D usually have other nutritional deficiencies. Okay. And they have bad feeding habit, not just exposure to sun, because I don't believe that we need to be exposed to sun. We need to eat well.
Okay.
The community cannot be exposed to sun as a whole community, but we need to eat well. And this is the first thing.
And the problem of sun exposure, it is not adequate, because in a sunny area, if we are waiting, if we are staying beside indoor and with windows, glass windows, the windows are not protective, because it inhibits the pathway of the ultraviolet. So beneficial ultraviolet is prohibited to reach the skin. This is why the sun is inefficient. And so I agree with Professor Magdi that we should take care of vitamin D supplementation, native vitamin D. And the modest dose is fine, because it was seen in some discussion that the big dose may lead to variability of vitamin D and playing with vitamin D receptors outside the inflammation. So a lot of problems. So small dose and continuous is better than big dose. And I think nutritional support is essential. If there is deficiency, we should support deficiency. And this is the wisdom of dealing with nutritional deficiencies in general.
So acute illness can lead to vitamin D deficiency?
Be associated with, yes.
Yes. One other aspect is that if we are talking about vitamin supplementation, we should tell the patients and the people that multivitamins have vitamin D and calcium. And we can result in loading of this patient with vitamin D. And if we are going to load this patient with vitamin D, toxicity will occur. Hypercalcemia will be there. And so we should be very careful, especially in patients with chronic kidney disease. Another aspect is we shouldn't encourage pharmacists to prescribe active vitamin D for our patients or for the general population. This is a very common mistake. I witness nowadays many patients coming with alpha-calcidol in their hand. And they said that vitamin D will protect against COVID. This is not true.
We need natural vitamin D.
Only the native vitamin D that it has that has a relation with infection prevention.
It
and
has
not the active vitamin D.
It behaves pleiotropically, but yes. The active vitamin D is the main player on parathyroid cells. So if we want the, and we have a question here on the chat, the drawback of hypovitaminosis D in immunity. A lot of observational studies showing that hypovitaminosis D is associated with autoimmune diseases, type 1 diabetes, etc. Although the randomized controlled study of supplementing patients with vitamin D was not associated with prevention of type 2 diabetes, but it seems that it's beneficial. And in transplantation, even transplantation, hypovitaminosis D may be associated with increased risk of rejection. And it is a matter of research.
If you allow me, Dr. Hussein, by the way,
yes.
To comment on this, the last point of Dr. Magdi. Unfortunately, with full respect to our cardiologist, Dr. Tariq Tantawi showed me many prescriptions for our respected colleagues from cardiology subspecialty. Nowadays, they prescribe routinely this 1-alpha 25 mic as a routine in their prescriptions, despite it is not a nutritional vitamin D as a cardiovascular protection. It is hazardous. Actually, it is very hazardous nowadays to prescribe this.
It is very bad because even I mentioned with Professor Al-Ghamdi that vitamin D, when it's tested at large, it was not associated with prevention of cardiovascular disease. And active vitamin D, if this is a state of native vitamin D, active vitamin D will add nothing. And the randomized controlled study showed no benefit of active vitamin D in this context. We have Dr. Tariq Tantawi with us if he wants to add to this point, because he is always concerned by the bad prescription
by
our colleagues. Okay, so we can take the comments of Professor Sobh. Please unmute yourself, Dr. Muhammad.
Okay, Hadra Ra'a Taban, وهي information بتيجي معظمها انك you give vitamin D, you have good response regarding COVID infection. انما السؤال بقى يعني the question is, these patients initially were in a set of hypovitaminosis D or they were in normal vitamin D? Yeah, am I going to give vitamin D without knowing the baseline status of the patient? That is a question. I know that most of our patients, when examined, most of them are in a set of hypovitaminosis D, and usually we prescribe supplementation of vitamin D. This is in our routine clinical practice. But if we have a patient who have normal vitamin D level, is still he in need of supplementation?
If we measure vitamin D, Dr. Muhammad, if we measure vitamin D and it is above 50, there is no need to give vitamin D. But if it is in the intermediate zone, we can give the supplement. If the natural supplement from the nutritional requirement of any adult is around 1,000 units, which is 20 microgram of native vitamin D, we give even 1,000 up to 5,000 per day, it is not hazardous. Right. There's no problem of this dose. But if vitamin D is above 70, there is no rule for vitamin D in this context. If we have hypercalcemia, for example, or other parameter or other problems of vitamin D, we will not give vitamin D. So if vitamin D is low, or if we don't measure vitamin D, we will give small dose for chronic, especially for hospitalized patient under the umbrella of COVID to satisfy their usual needs. I am totally convinced by the style of the Bergmatic protocol I just mentioned. If level is less than 20, they give the patient 50,000 units of native vitamin D. If it's between 20 to 30, they give the patient 25,000. So if the level is low or modest, we give vitamin D. If it is high level, it's no need for vitamin D. Dr. Riyad, please, if you would like to.
Well, thank you very much, really, for this nice talk. It's short, but it's really informative. You know, a couple of points about, really, you mentioned the sun exposure and how much really we have to. I'm sure it depends a lot also on the altitude, as you mentioned, and also the time of the day when we are exposed to the sun, because really it depends upon the ultraviolet light, the medium, the short wave, and the other one that usually disappears when the sun sets. So you don't really need to expose yourself without any help if it's at sunset. Secondly, you have to remember the color of the skin and the time really needed. And that's why we have a lot of deficiency in dark colored individual because of the melanin that we have. That's one thing. You know, I was looking about when I gave a talk about the conundrum of vitamin D, I was looking about a white individual, skin individual, needs 20 minutes exposure to the sun, and the equal amount of time for a dark skin individual, it will require 120 minutes. So really you have to take this in consideration. Again, the amount of the skin, the part of the skin being exposed also, it makes a lot of difference. For infection, as you mentioned, I mentioned last time when Dr. Saeed Al-Ghamdi, I have a very nice picture, I wish I sent it to you. In the old World War II, they have hospitals with TB. All of them, they move them to the outside. On daily basis, they put them in the morning, and a couple of hours just in the sun, how to treat TB. And that was the only way really looking for it. So we know that the innate immunity is affected. We know it's the exposure to the sun. We know also that with upper respiratory infection, as you mentioned, flu-like illnesses, and COVID is part of it, really. So it's no surprise that when you supplement vitamin D, it may help. But as you mentioned, we are really lacking randomized controlled studies, as you explained it elegantly. I have nothing really more to say, except it was a nice talk.
Thank you very much, Professor Riyad, and I'm happy that you addressed the how to be exposed to sun, because at certain time point, I imagine that because I have a dark skin, I am protected. But when I read in details, I found no.
You need more time.
More time to be exposed. Yes, and congratulations for the timing. The best timing is in the morning, because in the morning, ultraviolet B is available. And the sun is not hot, is not dangerous to the skin. So either in the morning from 7 to 10 o'clock in the morning, or even in the midday, but to be for shorter time, because sun is may hurt the skin. And as you mentioned in the evening, the protective type of ultraviolet light is not protective in this time. So either in early morning, for a longer period of time, or in the midday, but to be careful from the heat of the sun. Am I right?
I agree 100%.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, dear Prof. Dr. Yasir Abhamid.
Thank you, Professor Hussein, for this very elegant talk as usual.
Rabbina khalik yamshi.
Malish, I want to ask, you said that the level is 50? We need the vitamin D above.
Yes.
50. Is it high level?
No.
Not high level?
Up to 50 is not high level. It is sufficient level.
Sufficient level from there. This is the upper normal of sufficient level.
Yes. Ah. But it's not harmful. It's not harmful level.
Okay. My second question is about our patients with chronic kidney disease. Who are usually having this dilemma of PTH and phosphorus and vitamin D deficiency. Do you meet any reports about how to deal with these patients with abnormalities in PTH or phosphorus in giving vitamin D, targeting the immunity, not the CKPMD?
This is away from COVID-19, and we discussed this issue in one of our meetings. If we wanted to have a beneficial effect of active vitamin D to suppress parathyroid glands, we should have sufficient level of native vitamin D as well.
And I mean, how to balance? Okay, go.
Yes, I understand.
We should, how to balance?
This is the point that I am totally convinced. Even if we don't do frequent monitor to vitamin D level, even to look at vitamin D even once when we treat the patient in stage 3 CKD. if you have hypovitaminosis D, give vitamin D in surplus amount. Even in dialysis patients, we can combine both native vitamin D and active vitamin D in these patients. To Dr. Magdi, I think Dr. Magdi wanted to interact here.
Yes, I want how to balance between if our patient have a COVID.
Yes, have a COVID. This is a problem, Dr. Yasser, because when I prepared the talk, I was restricted to the publications. And as you know, the number of patients with COVID and the CKD, mortality is higher in CKD patients, and you will not find a detailed report to satisfy your question. I think so.
It was very elegant talk, thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Yasser.
Highly informative for this point, thank you.
But I find the point, vitamin D is a simple alternative to tocilizumab. It is nice. And it is potentiating the action of remdesivir. It's nice.
And we need to talk about zinc.
Okay, Dr. Magdo.
Dr. Hussein, yes, Dr. Yasser has raised a very important issue. Is how much will you treat and who to treat? To my mind, last time when Dr. Saeed Al-Ghamdi said he is treating his patient, I said that I only treat symptomatic patient. I didn't mean that patient with vitamin D deficiency. No, those with mild deficiency, but they have symptoms that otherwise you can't find any reason. Sometimes a patient say, I have a muscular pain, I have general weakness, my immunity is not good. And he has a lab work in his hand showing low vitamin D. So I treat him with vitamin D. But after many years of doing this, patient afterward came to me and say, I feel nothing, I didn't improve. Usually he's not improving. But we need to correct, yes, if you are going to correct him. Regarding in patient with coronavirus, this is a question to Dr. Hussein.
So the first point, Dr. Magdi, I prefer testing vitamin D because it's now very cheap and available. It is very satisfactory to me and to the patient. If I have
how can you follow this patient? You need to repeat test. You need to repeat it every 6 months.
My preferred style of replenishment of vitamin D, because sometimes when we do the level, we find 4, 5. It is very,
yes,
very...
Yes, this patient with severe deficiency, yes.
We give to these patients the vitamin D, either by intramuscular 200,000 units every...
But again, again...
And then after 3 or 4 doses, we repeat the level. If it is above 50, we stop vitamin D for a while. If it is less than this, we can go and continue supplementing the patient with vitamin D. This is because I am believing in deficiencies. If we have deficiencies, we should correct the deficiencies.
That's for sure, but it makes it extremely difficult to ask for vitamin D every 6 months and you give him injection every 6 months. What I do and what I believe is that you have to educate the patient where is vitamin D in their food. Okay. This will be much, much better than medications.
But we have endpoints, Dr. Magdi. And if,
yeah, I know.
Even for...
I totally agree. For it is a very, very gray zone.
Mm-hmm. Yes, okay.
It's very gray. And there is no single proof that giving vitamin D will correct anything in medicine.
Yes.
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 And many proofs that correct everything in medicine.
The problem... If we wait randomized controlled studies is not the solution for everything. And there are many issues treated without randomized controlled studies. Because at the end of the day, randomized controlled study is an experimental environment. If we have deficiencies...
It's not a true environment.
Yeah. Okay.
So let me ask you. If you are going to... If you have a patient with vitamin D deficiency and he is a coronavirus, at which stage will you treat him? And what type of vitamin D and what route of treatment? Injection or oral? And for how long?
Whatever the strategy, Dr. Magdi, because I read all intervention studies, more than 15 randomized control studies are ongoing nowadays. They are using different protocols. Either small dose on daily basis, either intermittent pulses, by oral way, capsule containing 500,000. It is a huge amount of vitamin
D. Huge. I read that there is 10,000 daily also. Yes, use 10,000 daily.
5,000 daily, 10,000 daily, 50,000, 200,000, 400,000. A lot of protocols giving oral, whatever. And I think any of them will work.
So,
and at which time? From the early beginning.
Okay. Again, it is an observational advice.
Yes.
And I think it is valid. But
it is accepted from theoretical point of view, but we are waiting further evidence from the randomized controlled study. Okay. Even if randomized controlled study stated a negative answer, I'm going to looking at them by criticism as well. Because the dogma, the dogma is the deficiencies should be corrected based on theoretical explanation. All these experimental and observational studies are valid. Even UK Biobank study, including 500,000 patients, there are criticism for the negative association raised by this study. Is obesity is associated with hypovitaminosis? So everything is complicated when we adjust the analysis. The univariate analysis showed a significant value of vitamin D deficiency, and the multivariate showed no difference. However, the criticism is there as well. So I think if there is deficiency, we treat deficiency. Nowadays, vitamin D level is very cheap in comparison to the past. If we do it once every 6 months or a year, I think it is not a problem at all.
Okay. Yeah.
Dr. Sobha, do you like to add here points?
Yeah, and بحكي يش أنا بحكم دائما in basics ومنطق.
Yes.
Number one, vitamin D is a nutritional hormone. We know. From research, we know it has a lot of actions, including this antibacterial, antifungal, antiviral. And effective immune system. So it is a beneficial drug, number one. Number two, in our daily observation, most of our patients are vitamin D deficient. Every 10 patients, I can say 7 of them at least are deficient vitamin D, which is strange. So most of our patients will need vitamin D. What I do, as you said, Dr. Hussein, it was expensive to screen or to analyze level of vitamin D, but now the cost is not that much. So it deserves to look for vitamin D for all our patients. As we do looking for hemoglobin A1C, T3, thyroid function in female patients, we have to look to vitamin D level in our team practice due to its value as a bleutrophic effect. Giving supplementation after many trials in real life with my patient, actually, when it is deficient, I give vitamin, usually I prefer monthly injection of 200,000 unit vitamin D, repeated 6 months, then every 3rd month, and looking for vitamin D level every year.
I think it is very, very nice, and I agree about this point. If we document hypovitaminosis D, because this is the very, it will lead to dramatic increase the level, and because if we advise the patient for daily use, then the patient will not be adherent to treatment. Dr. Yad, do you like to add?
Yes. I think to be a little not in agreement with Dr. Majdi, because we are measuring vitamin D regularly.
Yes.
It's not cheap, but it's not that expensive in comparison to other tests. And Dr. Sobh mentioned that 7 out of 10 patients, they are deficient. I tend to agree even maybe more. Yes. It's really, I don't know, every patient we see in our clinic is deficient with vitamin D. Barely to see one from different nationalities. Again, we see in our practice from Yemeni group, Jordanian, Palestinian, Syrian, Saudis, they will come really to our place. And all of them, really, they have vitamin D deficiency. It's quite low. You'll be surprised. 10 with the normal, it's quite low. So what we treat them really, we have now the 50,000 tablet.
Yes.
Once weekly for 8 weeks. Once monthly for the rest of the other 6 months. By the third month, that means 6 months, we repeat the level.
Okay.
We are not repeating it really every month, every 2 months, every 6 months. And it's not really a burden on the patient. And the tablets are so cheap. The bottle that contains 50,000, which contains around 15 tablets, means it will continue for almost the whole course of therapy. It is 10 JDs for us. That means up to $15, not more than that, the whole course. It is a cheap drug nowadays. Initially, it was expensive, not available. It's a cheap medicine. It's easy to monitor. And the potential side effect is low if you keep monitoring with other testing, the calcium, as you mentioned, and if you have something. That's one thing. Secondly, we have patients, they come again from our cardiologists, from our group, they are giving them 1-alpha.
Yeah.
Calciferol. And that's no replacement, really, yes, for the vitamin D itself. Okay. If you need vitamin D, you need the vitamin D proper, not really the 1-alpha or 125 dihydroxy. Some of them, they will come really with this. And that will give you sometimes vitamin hypercalcemia and intoxication. Our dialysis patient, there is nothing wrong by giving them the 1-alpha and the vitamin D also at the same time, knowing that at least every 2 to 3 months, we monitor the levels. So that's really my comment. Overall, I'm really amazed with the discussion that this topic is bringing now from Dr. Saeed Al-Ghamdi to this, and I'm sure we'll continue because it's in our daily practice. We have patients with real, real deficiency of vitamin D.
I think it is a wise approach as well. The problem here, the vitamin D injection is the cheapest way, the cheapest form in Egypt. Very, very okay. Cheap. And but if I'm speaking in a scientific way, the meta-analysis confirmed that small doses giving orally is associated with lower respiratory infection. And it is the link with this, with protective effect is superior to the boluses. So this to be honest in speaking. So either to give vitamin D by any style, to supplement the deficiencies, I think this is one of the conclusion of this meeting, although the randomized controlled studies are lacking, but there is some convincing from theoretical points of view is to supplement vitamin D. Dr. Sobh, do you like to add?
No, this is very nice.
Okay. In one of professors or my colleagues want to add anything? Dr. Magdi? دكتور مجدي do you like to add?
والله انا احب اشكرك على البرين ستورمنج اللي انت عملته يعني thank you very much for this brain storming.
شكرا لحضرتك وكل الاساتذه العظماء اللي موجودين
presentation ويعني I thank everyone who shared in this conversation يعني and this discussion thank you very much.
اعتقد بعد الكلام الجميل ده يبقى ما عادش فيه كلام متشكرين جدا. شكرا دكتور رياض. شكرا دكتور صبحي.
اهلا اهلا يا فندم. اهلا اهلا.
شكرا دكتور سعيد. شكرا للجميع. اشكركم. ان شاء الله هتلاقوها على اليوتيوب بعد ساعه ان شاء الله.
الله يخليك. شكرا جزيلا.
مع السلامه. مع سلامه الله. مع السلامه.
السلام. مع السلامه. اهلا اهلا.